came to study abroad in Canada, I could say that I had never really walked anywhere. Now, what do I mean by this? Well, literally, I had never really walked to my school or to the grocery store, which, by the way, was less than 5 minutes away from my house. My roommates in Canada laughed at me because I didn't know how to use the public transport system. It's something that I had never done before. I am from El Salvador, which is currently one of the most dangerous countries in the world that are not in the war zone. Along with its neighbors, Guatemala and Honduras, they form the Northern Triangle in Central America, famous for its high homicide rate. Currently, my country is bleeding itself dry. Every day, a new family can start mourning the death of a loved one. Now, if you're from the middle class or above, the chances of this happening to you are less, but you still drive everywhere, and you don't take public transport, because being killed or assaulted on the bus would not be surprising at all. Children are being raised in between four walls, and being a parent means living in constant fear for the lives of your children. Now, I was very privileged. My parents protected me a lot, and nothing ever really happened to me. But I am the exception. Now, many of my friends back home say that they're tired of speaking of the violence in the country, that we should talk about the beautiful things, the lakes, the oceans, the mountains, the volcanoes. But I question it, because how can we talk about anything else when violence is the number one problem in our country and when there are people dying every single day? Our silence is a privilege. But what happens to those who don't have that privilege, who have to face fear every single day of their lives? This violence that I am talking about is caused by a huge gang problem that has embedded deep roots in the social fabric of the Central American nations, consequently causing a high rise in the number of unaccompanied minors trying to seek refugee status abroad. Most of them never get it, and many of them died in their attempt. Back in the country, youth is the number one target for the gangs. We are losing an entire generation to this violence, as young people are both the perpetrators and the victims of it. Many of them are orphans, and when they fail to find a family in their own homes, they usually seek it in the gangs. El Salvador has the highest rate of homicide for victims under the age of 19. And if you want a general overview of the murder rate in general, I can tell you that in 2016, we closed the year with 5,217 murders. Now, if you do a little math, that is around 14 every single day. That means that in less than 2 weeks, all of the people in this room would be gone. This is incredibly high, but even higher when you take into consideration that El Salvador is around two-thirds the size of Vancouver Island, with a population of only 6 million people. And this is why I am standing on this stage today, to tell you a story that I don't think is often told in North America. When we think of refugees, we think of them in terms of their arrival to our country, or most of them crossing the borders that we humans so viciously to protect, but we fail to acknowledge the trauma and the violence that they are fleeing from. Now, let's challenge the norm. Let's challenge the norm by acknowledging that this is happening. And let's look at these people beyond the word migrant. A migrant is somebody looking for better economical and educational opportunities abroad. Sometimes, migrants want to reunite with family. Refugees, asylum seekers, on the other side, it's a different story. They flee their country because they have no option. They're fleeing for their life. Because their government fails to provide protection to them, they have to seek it elsewhere. For asylum seekers, the denial of it has deadly consequences. So before we jump more into it, I want to give you some context. Where did this violence come from? Where did the gangs come from? For that, we have to travel back in time to the 1980s, when the country faced a brutal civil war that lasted 12 years. It took the life of around 75,000 people. Unfortunately, I can say that those numbers are still comparable to the ones we face today. If you multiply 14 murders per day over the period of 12 years, you get a number of around 61,000 people. Back in the 80s, the conflict was between the FMLN rebels and the Salvadorian military state. The conflict is studied often as an offshoot from the Cold War rivalry between the US and the USSR, because the rebels had a Marxist ideology, while the military government received tons of funding aid from the US, both in military and in soldier training. Now, as it usually happens with armed conflict, people started to flee. This is what I will call the first wave of refugee-seeking people towards the US. Nevertheless, I must mention that less than 1% were given that status, even though by international law they classify as so. Once in there, many in LA, they were considered illegal immigrants. They learned how to defend themselves by forming their own gangs to protect themselves from already established Mexican and African American gangs that lived in LA. In 1992, when the peace accords were signed back in El Salvador, the US decided to deport all of them back. They came back to a country that they didn't really know anymore. Many of them had grown up in LA and they didn't really speak Spanish. The US government also denied the release of the criminal background of the deportees. And so, when the Salvadorian state was trying to rebuild itself after many years of war, they didn't really know who these new civilians were or what crimes had they committed or if they had committed crimes at all. The situation turned out to be a disaster. And now they have grown so much that they are one of the most feared forms of organized crime that currently exists. Now, you must be wondering, what is life like now in the country? Well, that is a really hard question to answer if you have not lived it through, but I want to give you an idea. Civilians flee between two opposing states, the official one and that of the gangs. The reason I call the gangs a state is because they mark territories with invisible lines that you cannot cross without asking for their permission. They charge something called rent. That is like a tax. Don't have enough money to pay the rent? Well, your head will be the price when it comes to the rest of the community. They kidnap children as young as 10 years old for them to join the gang. To join the gang, you have to kill or rape somebody. It is their law. This is happening to kids as young as 10 years old. Study done by UNICEF show that 27% of schools reported that they had been missing students due to the gangs. And around 62% of them reported that their students had been displaced from their homes for the same reason. Now, by making them join the gang at such a young age, you raise them in an environment that naturalizes violence. You make them join this circle of oppression that by being forced to join the gang and then forcing others to join it as well, you perpetrate this cycle. Mothers try to keep their children away from it. They don't really have a choice. If the gang wants your children, they will get them, alive or dead. Police brutality has also increased. A study done by the Human Rights Commission in El Salvador showed that policemen were effectively committing unlawful killing. So, what do you do? What do you do when the very institution designed to protect you also kills you? How do you tell a 15-year-old who is being threatened with murder every single day of their life if they don't join the gang not to leave, when it seems like that is the only option that they really do have? All of these children, teenagers, young men, they're born dead. Socially, they do not exist. They're invisible to the government and to the middle class and above. What do you have to lose once you're born there? And so they flee. And when they flee, they seek the acknowledgement of the international community. But it seems like this one is failing them too. They don't just seek asylum in the US, but other countries like Belize, Panama, Costa Rica, and Mexico. But policies like the southern border plan in Mexico have created yet another obstacle for asylum seekers to reach the destination. Essentially, the U.S. has outsourced this problem to Mexico by funding the implementation of this policy. Consequently, many are being sent back to face their death. A study done by Elizabeth Kennedy, a Fulbright scholar, demonstrated the reasons why these children leave. 61% of girls said that violence and gang threats were the determinants, and so did 59% of boys. This led them to take the decision to make a journey that should not be taken lightly. Just to give you a glimpse of the horrors that these people expect to experience, girls take anticonceptive pills before they embark on the journey because they expect to be raped multiple times before they reach the border. The price that these people pay for peace is a really high one. A study done by the UN Commission for Refugees said that 17,000 unaccompanied minors reached Mexico in 2015. Guess how many of them were even refugees? Half of them were classified as refugees and were deemed qualified to receive such title, but only 52% of them received it. Even the law backs up their claims. The Cartagena Commission, an agreement, is a legal document that was signed by Mexico and that extends the definition of refugee towards people that are fleeing from generalized violence and threats to their human rights. So, under Mexican law, these children should technically receive international protection, but they are not. So being backed up both by research and by law, you might ask, why are not more of them given asylum? Well, asylum seekers face many obstacles on their ways. One of them is detention centers. Detention centers are prison-like structures where minors are taken by immigration once they are found. And here, they are locked up for months, even for years. They're not allowed to attend school. They don't receive any legal counseling. They're kids. They don't know how to fill out asylum applications. Many of them abandon the refugee process for fear of never getting in or being deported, something that they cannot really afford. These people are invisible in life and in death, inside and outside their country. Not providing the right structures for asylum seekers and for facilitating this process is breaking international law, especially when a legal document was signed to guarantee that to them. And so it is with a heavy heart and a lot of sadness that I end this story that I came here to tell you. If these people are refugees, then let's acknowledge them and treat them as such. That's